In this video, I'm going to cover two simple techniques that can help you make your 3D scenes appear cartoon-like. These techniques are rim lighting and toon shading, so stay tuned, no pun intended. Let's start with toon shading, which is also known as cell shading. The idea behind this technique is to replace the smooth transition that diffuse lighting provides with a sharp transition between several brightness levels. This should make the models look similar to what we see in some cartoons where the artist appears to switch brushes or colors halfway through the body of the character. Toon shading is very simple to implement. In the fragment shader, we need to define the number of transitions between color levels. Let's see the difference between 8 levels and 4. Nice! You can play with it until you are happy with the result. You can also make this a uniform variable and control it from the application. The next step is to calculate the reciprocal of the number of levels. The standard diffuse factor is calculated using the cosine function and provides values between 0 and 1. Negatives are of course not viewable. We're going to replace the cosine wave with several stairs where every stair is the size of this reciprocal. During our lighting calculations, if the diffuse factor turns out to be positive, it means that the current fragment returns diffuse lighting. In this case, we multiply the diffuse factor by the number of toon levels. This provides a fraction between 0 and the number of toon levels. We apply the sil function in order to calculate the nearest integer, which is greater than or equal to this fraction. We can now multiply this integer by the reciprocal of the number of toon levels in order to get one of the so-called stairs between 0 and 1. The lighting calculations continue as usual, and we use the updated diffuse factor to calculate the diffuse color. Notice that the use of the sil function makes the final result somewhat brighter, because even small diffuse factors will be rounded up to the reciprocal of the number of toon levels. This behavior is of course true for every value of the diffuse factor. Another option is to use the floor function, which tends to make the final result somewhat darker. Also know that the toon shading calculation is wrapped by a global flag that enables or disables it. This flag can be controlled by the demo by clicking on C. And finally, when toon shading is enabled, we should probably disable specular lighting, which seems less appropriate for this type of technique. The second technique is rim lighting. As the name suggests, it brightens up the outer edges of an object. It is often combined with toon shading, which is why I included both in this video, but you can also use it on its own if it makes sense visually. The way that rim lighting works is the triangles that are directly in front of the viewer return zero lighting as a result of this technique. The regular lighting equation still applies, of course. As the triangle starts facing away from the viewer and before it becomes completely back-facing, the rim lighting effect increases. This is somewhat counterintuitive to what we know of diffuse lighting, where the lighting effect is at its peak when the light vector is perpendicular to the surface. Again, this is not a photorealistic effect, so the only question is whether you think it contributes to the feeling that you are trying to convey to the viewer. This technique is also simple to calculate. I factored out the calculation to a function called calcRimLightFactor. This function takes the pixel-to-camera vector and the normal vector. The pixel-to-camera vector was previously calculated as part of specular lighting, so you should have it by now if you follow the previous tutorials. We start by taking the dot product of the pixel-to-camera and the normal vectors. Same as with diffuse lighting, the result gets closer to 1 as the two vectors become aligned with each other. The result is exactly 1 when the pixel-to-camera vector is perpendicular to the surface, same as the normal. In this case, we want the rim lighting effect to be 0, so we subtract this from 1. So now the effect increases as the angle between the pixel to camera and the normal vector grows. We use the max function to make sure we don't get negative values, and we also raise the factor to the power of a global variable called rim light power. This value controls the fall off of the effect. The higher the value, the sharper the drop that the effect experiences. The final rim factor is multiplied by the diffuse color and combined with the ambient, diffuse, and specular colors before we continue with the lighting equation. This effect can also be controlled by clicking on R in the demo. So that's it for today. I hope you found this tutorial useful. If you did, please hit the like button and subscribe. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.